Meeting come to order, please. Roll call. Press your present button, please. Oh, well. We're all here. Bear with us, folks. Record it. Thank you. Announcement, staff.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. I have a couple of announcements. First of all, we do have a couple of withdrawals. Item 23, Enderly Large Lot Subdivision, has been withdrawn, and item 27, Waterleaf Final Plat, has been withdrawn. We have also had a request for a non-agenda item regarding King's Chapel. The sole purpose of this is to change a street name. Evidently, there was a street name that was placed on the plat that was not appropriate per the emergency management folks, and they asked if we could change that street name.
Any objection? Anyone?
I'd suggest, Mr. Chairman, if we could do it after item 29, because we got it still under the plats. That may be a good practice.
Okay, that's fine. It'll be agenda item 29A.
I guess so. A couple other items. Next week, and I think you've already received or have been sent memos to that effect, 3:30 here in this auditorium, we're going to have the kickoff meeting for the comprehensive traffic study, and you've all been invited to that. And a week and a day later, same place at 4:30 in the auditorium, we will have a educational impact fee workshop. The consultant will be here for that as well. Mike, did I leave anything out of your announcement? And I believe, other than that, Mr. Chairman, that's all I got.
Thank you, sir. Consideration of the minutes of 7:14. Any changes or corrections? Motion made and seconded. Prepare to vote. Vote now. Record it. Motion carries. Consideration of the consent agenda. Any commissioner wishing to pull an item for separate discussion, please say so now, otherwise we'll take it as a whole. Anyone? None? Staff?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We'll begin with item number 3, Dunblane. Performance bond for roads, drainage, and erosion control, $406,000. Recommendation, convert to maintenance in amount of $175,000 and extend for a period of 1 year. Item 4, Farms at Clovercroft, Section 1, performance bond for water, $41,250. Recommendation, convert to maintenance in the amount of $6,187.50 and extend for a period of 1 year. 5, Farms at Clovercroft, Section 1, performance bond for landscaping, $45,650. Recommendation, convert to maintenance in the amount of $13,700 and extend for a period of 8 months. Item 6, Farms at Clovercroft, Section 1, performance bond for wastewater collection system, $116,000. Recommendation, convert to maintenance in the amount of $34,800 and extend for a period of 2 years. Item 7, Farms at Clovercroft, Section 1, performance bond for roads, drainage, and erosion control, $410,000. Recommendation, convert to maintenance in the amount of $240,000 and extend for a period of 1 year. Item 8, Hart's Landmark, maintenance bond for water, $20,600. Recommendation, extend in current amount and review it January 2017 meeting. Item 9, Silver Stream Farm, Section 4A, maintenance bond for roads, drainage, and erosion control, $7,000. Recommendation, extend in current amount for a period of 6 months. Item 10, Temple Hill, Section 16, Phase C, performance bond for water, $19,949.01. Recommendation, release the bond. Item 11, Temple Hill, Section 16, Phase C, performance bond for sewer, 48,000 $884.76. Recommendation, release the bond. Item 12, Temple Hill Section 16, Phase C, performance bond for roads, drainage, and erosion control, $300,000. Recommendation, convert to maintenance amount of $190,000 and extend for a period of 1 year. Item 13, The Grove Section 2, maintenance bond for wastewater collection, $136,200. Recommendation, extended current amount for a period of 1 year. Item 14, The Grove Section 2, maintenance bond for roads, drainage, and erosion control, $375,000. Recommendation, reduced to the amount of $195,000 and extend for a period of 1 year. Item 15, The Grove Section 4, performance bond for roads, drainage, and erosion control, $275,000. Recommendation, convert to maintenance amount of $140,000 and extend for a period of 1 year. Dropping down to final plats under item 24, final plat review for Falls Grove Section 3, containing 22 lots and 51 acres, located off Eudaley-Covington Road in the 5th Voting District. The plat is in order, and staff recommends approval of the final plat with the following stipulations. One, the posting of performance bond in the amount of performance bond for roads, drainage, and erosion control in the amount of $375,000. Two, the establishment of performance bond for water improvements in favor of Millcroft and Utility District in the amount of $27,000. Three, establishment of a performance bond for wastewater collection in the amount of $59,800. Four, the execution of stormwater maintenance agreement, submission of an operation and maintenance plan for stormwater improvements. Five, dedication of right-of-way along Eudaley-Covington Road as indicated on the final plat. And six, submission of the final plat in DWG format on recordable media based on the Tennessee State Plane Coordinate System prior to signature and recording of the plat. Now on to item 29, final plat review for Silver Stream Farm, Section 4G, containing 16 lots and 8.84 acres located off Rocky Fork Road in the 5th Voting District. This plat is in order, and staff recommends approval of the final plat pending the following stipulations. One, the posting performance bond amount of $175,000 for roads, drainage, and erosion control. This bond amount is based on work completed to date. Two, the posting of performance bond for water improvements, the amount of $90,000 as specified by Nolensville College Grove Utility District. Three, the posting of performance bond for sewer improvements in the amount of $121,000 as specified by Metro Nashville Water and Sewer Services. Four, the posting of performance bond for landscaping improvements in the amount of $65,890. Five, payment in lieu of road improvement fee in the amount of $5,733 prior to signature and recording of the final plat. Six, second entrance to the development from Rocky Fork Road, as well as the associated right turn lane, be completed prior to signature and recording of the plat. Seven, execution recording of stormwater maintenance agreement, submission of an operation and maintenance plan for stormwater improvements. And eight, submission of two copies of the final plat in DWG format on recordable media based on the Tennessee State Plane Coordinate System prior to signature and recording of the plat.
Motion second, prepare to vote. Vote now. Record it. Motion carries. Thank you. Any old business, staff? Any old business, Joe?
No.
Agenda items. Agenda item 16, non-residential site plan review for Fiddler's Glen, non-traditional wastewater treatment and disposal system, revised on 182 acres located off Murfreesboro Road in the 5th Voting District. Staff.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A site plan for this non-traditional wastewater treatment and disposal system was approved at the December 2015 meeting. The system is intended to serve a residential subdivision that is planned for the property. A concept plan for the subdivision will be considered as item 18 on this agenda. The applicant is now proposing approval of a revised site plan in order to relocate one of the disposal areas that will be transferred to the wastewater utility provider upon completion of the system and recording of the first final plat for the subdivision the system will serve. The relocation is being made at staff's request in order to facilitate a vehicular connection between this property and a proposed development on an adjoining property. No other changes are proposed. County's wastewater consultant has reviewed the revised site plan and is recommending approval. These changes are minor in nature, and staff recommends approval of the revised site plan. Prior to final plat submittal for the first section of the proposed subdivision, a zoning certificate must be obtained for the completed treatment and disposal system. Prior to the issuance of the zoning certificate, the applicant shall provide the following. Number one, a letter from TDEC indicating that the non-traditional wastewater treatment and disposal system was installed and is functioning. Two, as-built drawings showing the location of the system components and a sealed certification letter from the design engineer indicating that the non-traditional wastewater treatment and disposal system was constructed in accordance with the approved construction plans and specifications. Three, a letter from the owner slash utility provider indicating that it has accepted the non-traditional wastewater treatment and disposal system and is currently operating same. Four, posting of a performance bond in the amount of $175,500 for the non-traditional wastewater treatment and disposal system as specified by the county's wastewater consultant. And number five, posting of a performance bond in the amount of $15,070 for landscaping improvements.
Thank you, sir. Questions of staff? Comments? Motion? Motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? Prepare to vote. Vote now. Holly, Sharon, you got it. Record the vote. Motion carries. Thank you. Agenda item 17, concept plan review for Daventry containing 80 lots on 131.91 acres located off Tullis Road in the 5th voting district. Robin, you said you want to make a comment?
I do.
Go ahead.
Mr. Chairman, prior to the meeting, I consulted with legal counsel regarding any potential conflicts of interest as a result of a single family resident project in another jurisdiction that I'm currently working with the applicant on. While I was advised by legal counsel there was no conflict of interest, out of an abundance of caution, I'm choosing to recuse myself from participation in the consideration of this request.
Thank you, ma'am. Staff?
The applicant is requesting concept approval for this 80-lot conservation subdivision in the Rural Development 1 Zoning District. The review of a concept plan is the first stage in the development approval process. The subject property totals approximately 132 acres in size and is located on Tullis Road. The site adjoins Bell Chase Farm subdivision to the north and the recently approved Clovercroft Preserve subdivision to the east. Portions of the site are covered by natural resources, including hilltops, areas of steep slopes, streams, and woodlands. Approximately 20% of the site is covered in tree canopy. The proposed development consists of 80 lots, which will range in size from approximately a quarter of an acre to approximately a half acre. The overall density is 0.61 dwelling units per acre. 61% of the site will be preserved in open space. Access to the proposed development will be provided from Tullis Road, which is classified as a local roadway by the major thoroughfare plan. Additional connections will be made to the Bell Chase Farm subdivision and Clovercroft Preserve. The traffic shed analysis performed by the applicant indicates that the proposed number of lots is within acceptable limits based upon the capacity of the existing roadways. The applicant submitted a turn warrant analysis, which indicates that turn lanes are not warranted at the Tullis Road entrance to the development. At their August 3, 2016 meeting, the County Highway Commission concurred with this finding. Within the development, the applicant is requesting a right-of-way width of 40 feet in order to locate sidewalks out of the right-of-way and a design speed of 25 miles per hour for internal roadway. Staff is in support of these requests. As the site straddles the boundaries between water districts, water service will be provided by both Millcroft and Utility District and Nolensville College Grove Utility District. Wastewater will be handled via a non-traditional wastewater treatment and disposal system, which was approved by this body at the December 2015 meeting. County's wastewater consultant has reviewed this information and has recommended approval. Staff recommends approval of this concept plan, along with the request for a 40-foot right-of-way width and a design speed of 25 miles per hour within the subdivision. It should be noted that once detailed construction and engineering plans are prepared in conjunction with the submittal of a preliminary plat, changes to the layout, including the potential for lot reduction, may be necessary. Number of items must be addressed with future submittals. Number one, submissions of roads, drainage, and erosion control plans for review and approval by the county engineer. Number two, submission of water plans for review and approval by Millcroft and Utility District. Number three, submission of water plans for review and approval by Nolensville College Grove Utility District. Number four, submission of the applicable construction plans for the required wastewater disposal facilities to TDEC, the county's consultant, and staff. Final plat must address the following. Number one, prior to final plat submittal, a zoning certificate must be obtained for the completed wastewater treatment and disposal system. Prior to the issuance of the zoning certificate, the applicant shall provide the following. A letter from TDEC indicating that said system was installed and is functioning. B, as-built drawings showing the location of all system components, and a sealed certification letter from the design engineer indicating that said system was constructed in accordance with the approved construction plans and specifications. C, a letter from the owner/utility provider indicating that it has accepted said system and is currently operating the same. D, the posting of a performance bond in the amount of $123,000 for the non-traditional wastewater and disposal system as specified by the county's wastewater consultant. And B, the posting of a performance bond in the amount of $40,920 for landscaping improvements. Number two, prior to consideration of the final plat, applicants shall submit HOA documents for review and approval by the county attorney's office. The HOA documents must be submitted with the final plat and the approved HOA documents recorded prior to the recording of the final plat. 3. Establishment of a performance bond for roads, drainage, and erosion control. 4. Establishment of a performance bond for water improvements in favor of Millcroft and Utility District. 5. Establishment of a performance bond for water improvements in favor of Nolensville College Grove Utility District. 6. Establishment of a performance bond for the wastewater collection system. 7. Submission of a landscaping plan and establishment of a performance bond for landscaping. 8. Execution of a stormwater maintenance agreement and submission of an operation and maintenance plan for stormwater improvements. And 9. Submission of the approved final plat in DWG format on recordable media based on the Tennessee State Plan Coordinate System prior to signature and recording of the plat.
Thank you, sir. Questions of staff? Anyone? Pete?
I don't like the idea of this 40-foot right-of-way for connecting roads between three or four subdivisions and two roads. This will be a cutoff road between Clovercroft Road and people headed south toward 96. You got dump trucks and school buses and stuff flying through here. There needs to be some sort of way to make Tullis and this new roadway a safer road for people to travel on. If people cut through here, they can miss a couple of underpasses on Wilson Pike and things of this nature. And I think we're looking too lightly at road safety in these new subdivisions on the 40-foot right-of-way, especially on cut through type roads.
I'm trying to figure out, if you cut through on Tullis, where are you going to go?
Going to South 96.
Tullis that comes out right there at one of the tunnels? Is that the Tullis Road I'm thinking? Is that Tullis?
He goes from Clovercroft to the underpass on Wilson Pike.
Come south?
Mr. Chairman, the right-of-way is not going to affect the actual road section.
I was going to get to that, but go ahead.
The road's going to be just as wide as it would be with a 50-foot right-of-way. And the reason we only do the 40 if it's a curb section subdivision, not on ditch section, because you need additional room for the ditches. But the county doesn't operate any utilities, so we don't need that additional room for utilities.
You understand that, Pete? Same road section as the 50-foot right-of-way. Anything else? Jack?
I'm getting more and more concerned about some of these traffic studies, and I mean, at a minimum, I think they would need a turning lane and all, and that sort of thing, at least in the middle of the road, if you were, I don't know what direction this subdivision's facing, but say if you were going north and turning left in the subdivision, I just think there needs to be a turning lane there.
As in a center lane?
Yeah, I'd like to see it on just about every subdivision, because it's, if there's a lot of traffic, which there is getting to be more and more traffic on Tullis Road, it would help speed up traffic, get them out of the lane.
I understand. Mr. Matheson, what do our regs say in response to Mr. Walton's comments?
Well, the zoning ordinance requires for any lot that's at least 50, I'm sorry, any subdivision with at least 50 lots, requires an analysis of the entrance, and essentially a turn lane warrant analysis, and one was provided for this development. That analysis indicated that turn lanes were not required, and we did share that turn lane analysis with the highway superintendent, who shared it with their traffic engineer, and they concurred with that finding, and as did the highway commission at their meeting last week.
Jack, what the reason I asked Mike that, I think it would require a regulation change to just simply say each and every subdivision have a turn lane, and I'm paraphrasing on your behalf here. Is that what you said?
Yeah, that's what I said.
Well,
I agree with everything that's been said. I would just like to see that looked at, or seems like every one of these subdivisions coming in and the traffic analysis says, well, they don't need a turning lane. And I think that's just a minimum. I don't know, obviously a three-lot subdivision might not need it, but
well, I think
as I drive along and I get caught behind somebody turning left into a subdivision, I don't, and say it's on Hillsborough Road where it's two lane or something, it's
you don't go up in the grass and go around them.
Well, I've done that.
Well, my point is that I think we need to look at that as a regulatory change, because the way it's stated now, if the traffic analysis says no, then that's the end of the discussion within our authority.
And I agree. I just point that out, I think.
Okay. Mr. Crohan?
Yeah, just for my information, it's not traditional wastewater. You've got two utility districts going. It's split.
Commissioner Crohan, the utility districts will only serve the water. The non-traditional wastewater system will be turned over to another utility provider. Jamie Reed, the engineer for the project, can tell you who will accept the wastewater treatment system, but it will only be run by one utility district.
We don't know which one.
Jamie, if you want to come up and answer for us, please.
Is that still Pinckney?
Yes.
Okay,
thank you.
Anything else, Don?
No, that'll do it, thank you, sir.
Anyone else, question or comment? Motion?
I can't hear you.
Oh, Commissioner, I'm sorry.
Thank you. Good evening, Commissioners. I am Greg Lawrence, the 4th District County Commissioner in the 4th District, which will be affected by this subdivision. And we have several residents from the community that have asked me to address you tonight with some of their concerns and some of the things they would like to hear some discussion on. I don't know how many are here. If you're here tonight from the community, would you stand up? We have a handful or so. Thank you. They're all supposed to wear the same shirt, but they missed a memo on that, I think. There's a few things that we'd like to hear some discussion on, and forgive me if this was mentioned in your earlier, when you ran through some of those details. You guys talk fast in these meetings, so I may have missed something, but construction traffic. Where is the construction traffic going to come coming out? Is it all going to be dumped out on Tullis Road? Is it going to be going a different direction? The concern being, as Commissioner Walton has said, Tullis Road is already getting a lot of traffic on it. Are we going to add a lot more to a already congested road with the construction traffic, or we're going to route it a different way? Another question is about the retention ponds. They would like to know, what are the contingency plans if those ponds fill up? There have been instances like we had in 2010 where we had a 500-year flood, and a lot of that area was underwater. So they were concerned. There are some concerns about the drainage. And are these retention ponds the kind that drain through and are empty most of the time? Or are they going to have water standing in them? And if so, because of concerns about the West Nile virus and now maybe even Zika virus, so we're going to have aeration systems on those ponds to make sure that the water continues to flow. And how will the water that's coming off of this new subdivision impact the surrounding subdivision? So those are some questions they would like to know about the retention ponds. There's a suggestion that you also might, we would ask you to consider, is putting a crash gate in where the 10 acres and the 121 acres merge. There's 11 homes in that 10, on that 10 acres, I think, planned there. And if you were to put a crash gate there, that would significantly reduce the traffic on Tullis Road, because that would prevent traffic from Bell Chase and Clovercroft Reserve from both sides from being able to come through there. And they could, they both have separate entrances off of Clovercroft, and both of them have two entrances. So you've already got the adequate number of entrances that you need on those two subdivisions. So that was another a suggestion that they would like for you to consider in this development. There's also some notes in the plat that says resources not found, that there are no wetlands, and there's no historic items of historic value on this property. We would like to respectfully disagree with that. There's a house on this property that is over 100 years old, and there's a cellar on that they know they have done the research on was made by hand, and there is a stone wall similar to the walls that we have on Wilson Pike up to the north in Brentwood that we believe they were built around the time of the Civil War. So these are items of historic value, and we think the record needs to reflect that. When we would propose that you amend the record to reflect those items in there. Another item, and this is not necessarily directly related to Daventry so much as it is the traffic in the area in general, but this is obviously going to affect the traffic in that area. There's a big problem at Green Hills and Clovercroft Road. This is where the Worthington subdivision dumps out onto Clovercroft Road. There's blind curves in both directions on that entrance there, and you've got about a 4-second reaction time to get out of there. And getting out of there in the mornings and or at peak traffic times is extremely difficult. And so we would like to request that a study be done, and I don't know if this is maybe part of the study that's being done on the traffic study that's being proposed, but there needs to be a light there, motion sensor light on at Green Hills and Clovercroft to make that a whole lot safer for those residents to be able to get out of the Worthington subdivision. So those are the five items that we had on the list tonight that we would like for you to consider. I want to thank all of you for your works and your service to Williamson County.
Thank you, sir. Another commissioner?
Yes.
Go ahead, Lou.
Chairman, I'm not going to repeat everything that Commissioner Lawrence said, but I'm Lewis Green. I live on 1016 Waller Road, Brentwood, Tennessee, 5th District, County Commissioner. Unless you've lived it, you don't know how bad it is, but I sometimes take that cut through to eliminate the two tunnels going north, because they take off at Tullis Road and comes out on Clovercroft Road. Construction traffic also takes that way to alleviate going through, and they can't negotiate the tunnels at that time. But when you get to the end of Tullis Road at Clovercroft, I've sat there too long trying to make a left turn, and I really chickened out and made a right and did a UE and come back. Now, it was last year, year ago, I was in Clovercroft Schools, was put in. I reduced the speed limit on Clovercroft Road from Tullis Road east for half a mile. I've caught more flack over that than most things that I've done as far as changing the speed limit. But something, and I know this is not in the scope of the developer, but it's something I think we need to address, and maybe the highway department needs to address this, but it's something that really needs to take a look at, because traffic on that road and with the construction traffic, it's going to be a serious situation. And I thank you.
Lou, I think you're right. It is a traffic highway department issue. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Discussion? Floyd, can you answer the question on the detention, retention ponds and the drainage offsite?
Sure. Those will be addressed at the preliminary plat. They'll submit the construction plans, which I haven't seen yet. But the way the requirements are, they don't increase the post-developed discharge through the 100-year storm for stormwater. And the detention ponds will likely drain out, but that's their call. They'll provide the design. But typically they drain in 24 to 48 hours. And they're not located in the floodplain, so that shouldn't be an issue. They shouldn't be flooded on a frequent basis. And they will have a maintenance agreement to guarantee the maintenance of those ponds with the homeowners association.
Things on site. Do we do that, or does the applicant do that?
We do that to some degree, in that the zoning ordinance requires that any structure or property that is individually listed on the National Register of Historic Places has some protection associated with it. My understanding, and Mr. Holmes can confirm this, but is that there are no National Register property structures or properties on this site.
That's correct, Mr. Masterson. There aren't any.
Thank you, sir.
Can be protected during that under the subregs as well.
You mean the walls?
Walls and things like that.
Okay. Good. Thank you. Any other questions? Holly?
Was going to be my follow-up question on the home. I mean, it's an ordeal to get a home on the historic register anyway, but it's not up to us to... I mean, if there's a home on there that's worth saving, and I'm not saying that there is, but the wall is definitely worth protecting. But that's not under our authority to do that.
The wall is the house, no.
So is that going to change the concept plan? If it wasn't noted, like Commissioner Lawrence was saying on the plat, is that going to change anything with the concept plan?
How does that get looked at again, Mike? I guess it's Holly's question, is it not?
Yeah, in terms of the structures, we did look at those and requested some additional information from the engineer, and our understanding is that those are located in open space and those can be protected. I don't know that there was a reference to the historic wall on the plat.
Was there not a reference to the wall, no.
But we can find out where that wall is located and address that with the preliminary plat and work to protect that.
Thank you. Any other questions? Who is the consultant? Did you miss seeing that wall?
No, sir. Tony
it's not
Groh,
a very tall wall, but
no, I agree. Tony Groh actually did the environmental study on that site and went out there, walked, and went through the basement of the house and everything. And I shot him an email when I first found out about this past week, and he said there's nothing as far as any type of historical issues with that house.
The wall.
I don't know exactly the location of the wall. That's all he told me. And he took pictures of it and sent it.
You're going to need to know that when you come back.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you. Any other questions, comments, thoughts, motion? Motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? Prepare to vote. Vote now. Record it. Motion carries. Thank you. Agenda item 18, concept plan review for Fiddler's Glen, containing 130 lots on 182 acres, located off of Murfreesboro Road in the 5th Voting District. Staff?
The applicant is requesting concept plan approval for this 130-lot conservation subdivision in the Rural Development 1 Zoning District. The review of a concept plan is the first stage in the development approval process. The subject property totals approximately 182 acres in size and is located on the south side of Murfreesboro Road opposite the King's Chapel development. The property is relatively flat, although portions of the site are covered by natural resources, including wetlands, streams, and woodlands. Approximately 30% of the site is covered in tree canopy. The proposed development consists of 130 lots, which will range in size from approximately a third of an acre to approximately a half acre. The overall density is 0.71 dwelling units per acre. 64% of the site will be preserved in open space. Access to the proposed development will be provided from Murfreesboro Road, which is classified as an arterial roadway by the major thoroughfare plan. The Tennessee Department of Transportation has approved the conceptual design for the turn lane improvements to Murfreesboro Road. Roadway stubs will be provided to serve as connections to properties to the south and west should they be developed in the future. The traffic shed analysis performed by the applicant indicates that the proposed number of lots is within acceptable limits based upon the capacity of existing roadways. Left and right-hand turn lanes will facilitate turn movements from Murfreesboro Road into the development. Within the development, the applicant is requesting a right-of-way width of 40 feet in order to locate sidewalks outside of the right-of-way and a design speed of 25 miles per hour for internal roadways. Staff is in support of these requests. As the site straddles the boundaries between water districts, water service will be provided by both Millcrofton Utility District and Nolensville College Grove Utility District. Wastewater will be handled via a non-traditional wastewater treatment and disposal system, for which a revised site plan appeared as item 16 on this agenda. As long as item 16 is approved, staff recommends approval of this concept plan along with the request for a 40-foot right-of-way width and a design speed of 25 miles per hour within the subdivision. It should be noted that once detailed construction and engineering plans are prepared in conjunction with the submittal of a final plat, changes to the layout, including the potential for a reduction of lots, may be necessary. A number of items must be addressed with future submittals. 1. Submission of roads, drainage, and erosion control plans for a review and approval by the county engineer. Such would include turn lane improvements on Murfreesboro Road. Turn lane improvements on Murfreesboro Road must be approved by TDOT prior to preliminary plat submittal. 2. Submission of water plans for review and approval by Nolensville College Grove Utility District. 3. Submission of water plans for review and approval by Millcrofton Utility District. And 4. Submission of the applicable construction plans for the required wastewater disposal facilities to TDEC, the county's consultant, and staff. The final plat must address the following. Prior to submittal of a final plat, turn lane improvements on Murfreesboro Road must be completed in accordance with the approved plans. 2. Prior to final plat submittal, a zoning certificate must be obtained for the completed wastewater treatment and disposal system. Prior to issuance of the zoning certificate, the applicant shall provide the following. A letter from TDEC indicating that said system was installed and is functioning. B, as-built drawings showing the location of all system components and a sealed certification letter from the design engineer indicating that said system was constructed in accordance with the approved construction plans and specifications. C, a letter from the owner/utility provider indicating that it has accepted said system and is currently operating same. D, the posting of a performance bond in the amount of $175,500 for the non-traditional wastewater treatment and disposal system as specified by the county's wastewater consultant. And E, the posting of a performance bond in the amount of $15,070 for landscaping improvements. 3. Prior to consideration of final plat approval, the applicant shall submit HOA documents for review and approval by the county attorney's office. The HOA documents must be submitted with the final plat and the approved HOA documents recorded prior to the recording of the final plat. 4, establishment of a performance bond for roads, drainage, and erosion control. 5, submission of water plans for review and approval by Millcrofton Utility District. 6, establishment of performance bond for water improvements in favor of Nolensville College Grove Utility District. 7, establishment of a performance bond for the wastewater collection system. 8, dedication of right-of-way 60 feet off the center line of Murfreesboro Road. 9, submission of landscaping plans and establishment of a performance bond for landscaping. 10, execution of a stormwater maintenance agreement and submission of an operation and maintenance plan for stormwater improvements. And 11, submission of the approved final plat in DWG format on recordable media based on this Tennessee State Plan Coordinate System prior to signature and recording of the plat.
Thank you, sir. Questions of staff? Comments? Pete?
Times about the swampland on this property, and I noticed one of your major roads with houses on it go through has swampland on one side of it and swampland on the other side of it. Have you taken all precautions to make sure this is not?
Is he in the high ground?
Huh?
Is he in the high ground with a swamp on each side?
That's what I know.
Okay.
People have asked me about it, how you're doing it and how you're handling it. It's just something that needs extra care taken care of.
Pete, are these like floodplain areas you're talking about, or just areas that are
just
wet, always wet?
Swampland or wetland.
I mean, we look at, you know, they're supposed to identify the wetlands, and they're obviously have to stay out of the map floodplains. But as far as, the, you know, there could be some soil types out there that don't show up during those resource analyses that may be wet. You know, I don't know if we'll always catch those, but we could have the consultant is here, and maybe they have some additional information about those soils. Jamie, anything?
Who is that?
No, we're just like the chairman said, we're trying to stay on the high ground with most of it. But as far as the soils that we've got, the roads and stuff are actually good soils, compactable type soils. In most of the areas, we're going down through there and filling above those to stay away from the streams and stuff. If you notice, we're fairly far away on each side, but we are going to talk across the top like you're talking about and put most of the lights through there. So, did I answer the question or go around?
You don't have any identifiable wetlands?
Yes, sir. The wetlands are shown on here. Yes, sir. We've done a full HD certification on the wetlands and the streams and the intermittent streams and stuff. And we've identified those. We're staying out of those. That's what I was saying. We know where the bad soils are. We've
Good.
Identified those, so we are staying out of those. All right.
Thank you. Other comments? Questions? I hear a second. Thank you. Motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? Prepare to vote. Vote now. Record it. The motion carries. Thank you. Agenda item 19. Concept plan review for McDaniel Farms containing 91 lots on 252 acres located off McDaniel Road in the 5th Voting District. Staff?
The applicant is requesting concept approval for the 91-lot conservation subdivision in the Rural Development 1 Zoning District. The review of a concept plan is the first stage in the development approval process. The subject property totals 252 acres and is located on the south side of McDaniel Road at its intersection with State Route 840. Portions of the site are covered by natural resources, including hilltops, areas of steep slopes, floodplain, and woodlands. Approximately 48% of the site is covered in tree canopy. The proposed development consists of 91 lots, all of which are approximately a half acre in size. The overall density is 0.36 dwelling units per acre. 73% of the site will be preserved in open space. Access to the proposed development will be provided by two entrances from McDaniel Road, which is classified as a local roadway by the major thoroughfare plan. The traffic shed analysis performed by the applicant indicates that the proposed number of lots is within acceptable limits based upon the capacity of the existing roadways. The applicant submitted a turn warrant analysis which indicated that turn lanes are not warranted at either of the development's access points. Within the development, the applicant is requesting a right-of-way width of 40 feet in order to locate sidewalks outside of the right-of-way and a design speed of 25 miles per hour for internal roadways. Staff is in support of these requests. Water service will be provided by Millcrofton Utility District. Wastewater will be handled via the Udaly Regional System. A site plan for additional disposal area was approved by this body at the April 2016 meeting. Staff recommends approval of this concept plan along with the request for a 40-foot right-of-way width and a design speed of 25 miles per hour within the subdivision. It should be noted that once detailed construction and engineering plans are prepared in conjunction with the submittal of a preliminary plat, changes to the layout, including the potential for a lot reduction of lots, may be necessary. Number of items must be addressed with future submittals. The preliminary plat must address the following. 1. Submission of roads, drainage, and erosion control plans for review and approval by the county engineer. 2. Submission of water plans for review and approval by Millcrofton Utility District. And 3. Submission of the applicable construction plans for required wastewater disposal facilities to TDEC, the county's consultant, and staff. Final plat must address the following. 1. Prior to final plat submittal, a zoning certificate must be obtained for the completed wastewater treatment and disposal system. Prior to the issuance of the zoning certificate, the applicant shall provide the following. A. Letter from TDEC indicating that said system was installed and is functioning. B. As-built drawings showing the location of all system components and a sealed certification letter from the design engineer indicating that said system was constructed in accordance with the approved construction plans and specifications. C. A letter from the owner/utility provider indicating that it has accepted said system and is currently operating same. D. Posting of a performance bond for said system as specified by the county's wastewater consultant. And E. The posting of a performance bond in the amount of $4,125 for landscaping improvements. 2. Prior to consideration of the final plat approval, the applicant shall submit HOA documents for review and approval by the county attorney's office. HOA documents must be submitted with the final plat and the approved HOA documents recorded prior to the recording of the final plat. 3. Establishment of a performance bond for roads, drainage, and erosion control. 4. Establishment of a performance bond for water improvements in favor of Millcrofton Utility District. 5. Establishment of a performance bond for the wastewater collection system. 6. Submission of landscaping plans and establishment of a performance bond for landscaping. 7. Execution of a stormwater maintenance agreement and submission of an operation and maintenance plan for stormwater improvements. And 8. Submission of the approved final plat in DWG format on recordable media based on the Tennessee State Plan Coordinate System prior to signature and recording of the plat.
Thank you, sir. Questions of staff? Yes, ma'am.
These last three items in the same district, around the same area, we just now added 301 lots. Does that not affect traffic? I mean, just because they're submitted at the same time, would one not impact the other? I mean, as far as requiring, like say item 19 came a month down the road, and you already had these other ones. I mean, and I know we're talking traffic next week, and that's probably not even something that, it's just a question I'm asking. I'm not saying that it has a, you know, hinges our vote.
My first instinct is to say it depends on proximity, I guess, of the subdivisions. If they were contiguous, yeah.
And I'll be honest, Pete, do you know in those areas how close these are? They're not close to the other two.
This is off McDaniel Road by Pete Mason.
Aren't any of them close to the other?
Not really. That I know of.
Well, I guess I'm just thinking it's the same general, you know.
Oh, I understand. It's all in the 5th district.
Right, it's all in the 5th district, and I'm just saying, what if they were? And there's a traffic study done, but these three are being submitted at the same time.
I think.
I know, but I'm just saying, if they were in close proximity, would that affect the traffic study?
Yes. I think staff would pick up on that fairly quickly if they were.
Okay.
contiguous, for example, in the worst case, and make sure that that traffic study anticipated development of three subdivisions.
I guess this is my question.
Yes, it would, and it's a, that's a valid point, without question.
It's going to continue to be a problem.
I think on this particular subdivision, which when they were here a few months ago for the wastewater, this particular subdivision and the one that's coming in on McDaniel Road, I'm sorry, on Lampkins Bridge Road, are in close proximity. Those ones I had a problem with just for the traffic, which again, we're going to discuss that next week. But also the crumbling of the roads. I mean, the roads are in dire need. It comes out at Arno, and you've got Page Middle, Page High, and all of the traffic. I mean, I'm being repetitive from, you know, a couple of months ago, which I know Arno Road is one of the roads on the new traffic study to be expanded, but that's a long time. These subdivisions are going to be built now. The roads literally need a lot of work on it. So I just have concerns about that with just putting these houses, Lampkins Bridge subdivision, on there, all the impact of the two schools, lots of cars. So.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Anyone else? Comment? Thought? Motion? Motion made. Excuse me, and seconded. Any further discussion? I see none. Prepare to vote. Vote now. Thank you. The motion carries. Agenda item 20, preliminary plats. Preliminary plat review for Enclave at Dove Lake Phase 1 containing 59 lots on 173 acres located off Nolensville Road in the 4th voting district. Staff?
A concept plan for this development was approved at the July 2016 meeting. The applicant is now requesting preliminary plat approval for the first phase of the development, which consists of 59 lots and approximately 148 acres of open space. The preliminary plat is consistent in layout with that depicted on the concept plan. The Tennessee Department of Transportation has approved the conceptual design for turn lane improvements to Nolensville Road. As was mentioned at the concept plan stage, the applicant is requesting a right-of-way width of 40 feet in order to locate sidewalks outside of the right-of-way and a design speed of 25 miles per hour for roadways within the subdivision. The applicant is also requesting a roadway grade variance of up to 11.3% for portions of Big Oak Road, which is an existing county road. Staff is in support of these requests. Staff recommends approval of this preliminary plat. In conjunction with final plat consideration, following items must be addressed. One, prior to submittal of a final plat, turn lane improvements on Nolensville Road must be completed in accordance with the approved plan. Two, prior to final plat submittal, a zoning certificate must be obtained for the completed wastewater treatment and disposal system. Prior to the issuance of the zoning certificate, the applicant shall provide the following. A letter from TDEC indicating that said system was installed and is functioning. B, as-built drawing showing the location of all system components and a sealed certification letter from the design engineer indicating that said system was constructed in accordance with the approved construction plans and specifications. C, a letter from the owner slash utility provider indicating that it has accepted said system and is currently operating same. D, the posting of a performance bond in the amount of $271,500 for said system as specified by the county's wastewater consultant, and E, the posting of a performance bond in the amount of $34,155 for landscaping improvements. 3, prior to consideration of final plat approval, the applicant shall submit HOA documents for review and approval by the county attorney's office. The approved HOA documents must be recorded with the final plat. 4, establishment of a performance bond for roads, drainage, and erosion control. 5, establishment of a performance bond for water improvements in favor of Nolensville College Grove Utility District. 6, establishment of a performance bond for the wastewater collection system. 7, submission of landscaping plans and establishment of a performance bond for landscaping. 8, dedication of right-of-way 60 feet off the center line of Nolensville Road. 9, execution of a stormwater maintenance agreement and submission of an operation and maintenance plan for stormwater improvements. And 10, submission of the approved final plat in DWG format on recordable media based on the Tennessee State Plan Coordinate System prior to signature and recording of the plat.
Thank you, sir. Questions of staff? Comments? Timmy?
This, I realize this is phase one of two phases, second phase probably being the second entrance, I believe, in July. And in concept plan, we had, the developer had talked about a second right turn lane on Nolansville. And it's not on here, but I mean, it's also in the second phase or a later phase. So just wanted to show that for the record.
Reminded, still there, huh?
Yeah.
Thank you. Anyone else? More thoughts? Motion? One of these days, I'm going to get you to pull that mic all the way up. We have a motion and a second. Excuse me. Any further discussion? Prepare to vote. Vote now. Record it. The motion carries. Thank you. I'm going to digress just 2 minutes. This is the fifth subdivision we've had that's requested 40-foot right-of-way and 25-mile-an-hour speed limit. Why is that not just, and we approve it every time, why is that not just a standard in our regulations?
Mr. Chairman, it's going to be that to
good.
Make that the standard.
I'm glad somebody else picked up on that. Thank you. Agenda item 21. Preliminary plat review for Falls Grove Phase 4 containing 55 lots on 49 acres located off of U Daly Covington Road in the 5th Voting District. Staff?
Mr. Chairman. A site plan for this development was approved at the September 2005 meeting. The applicant is now requesting preliminary plat approval for the fourth phase of the development, which consists of 55 lots and approximately 22 acres of open space. The preliminary plat is generally consistent in layout with that depicted on the site plan. The applicant is requesting a right-of-way width of 40 feet in order to accommodate sidewalks outside of the right-of-way. The applicant is also requesting a design speed of 25 miles per hour for roadways, as well as road grade variances up to 12.97% as depicted on the site plan within this phase of the subdivision. Staff is in support of these requests. Staff recommends approval of this preliminary plat. In conjunction with final plat consideration, the following items must be addressed. One, prior to consideration of final plat approval, the applicant shall submit HOA documents for review and approval by the county attorney's office. The approved HOA documents must be recorded prior to the recording of the final plat. Two, establishment of a performance bond for roads, drainage, and erosion control. Three, establishment of a performance bond for water improvements in favor of Millcroft and Utility District. Four, establishment of a performance bond for the wastewater collection system. Five, submission of landscaping plans and establishment of a performance bond for landscaping. Six, execution of a stormwater maintenance agreement and submission of an operation and maintenance plan for stormwater improvements. And seven, submission of the approved final plat in DWG format on recordable media based on the Tennessee State Plane coordinate system prior to signature and recording of the plat.
Thank you, ma'am. Questions? Comments? Thoughts? Tammy?
I noticed the 12.97% or several of the roads, or is it just a couple of roads? Y'all recall?
It's two roads or a couple of different places on one road. Actually, when they were here years ago at site plan, the engineer had actually called those out on the site plan, but they didn't get a motion, was not taken at that meeting, so they have to be addressed here at preliminary plat. But I think at that time we went back in the minutes, and Mr. Crohan had a concern about them being at that time 13%, and they made some adjustments and brought them down a little bit, but they also created some landing areas at the intersection, so they flatten out pretty good. So it's an improvement over the original design, but yeah, they were pushing the limits of what would be an acceptable variance, I think. And one comment too on that is this was approved under old slope standards. So now we don't let them have lots on areas, you know, greater than 25%. I think that's going to help with the road design. They're not going to be in situations where they have to do, you know, getting areas that are as steep. At least that's what I hope.
So along that lines, are there lots that will be that don't apply to that steep grade now that these will be approved under because it was in 05?
I don't recall if there are lots that were identified on this plat that are going to be that have slopes beyond 25%. Do you know if that was?
I don't think there are.
And that's fine. I was just curious.
Any that would be marked as a critical lot at this phase. So.
That answer your question, Tammy?
Yep.
Thank you. Anyone else? Question, comment? Thoughts? Motion? He's going to do them all. Did I hear a second? Thank you. Motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? Prepare to vote? Vote now. Record it. Motion carries. Thank you. Agenda item 22, preliminary plat review for Fox and Canyon, containing 49 lots on 92 acres located off Harlan Road in the 8th Voting District. Staff?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The concept plan governing this development was approved by this body at the May 2016 meeting. The applicant is now requesting preliminary plat approval for this 49-lot conservation subdivision. The preliminary plat is identical in layout to that depicted on the approved concept plan. As stipulated in the concept plan approval, a landscaping plan which reflects a Type C buffer between the portion of the proposed construction entrance that is located within the Harsh Landmark subdivision and the adjacent lot that is located within the Farmington subdivision has been submitted. The buffer material shown on this plan must be installed prior to the issuance of a land disturbance permit, and a maintenance bond for this landscaping will be required in conjunction with final plat approval of the first section of the development. The applicant has submitted hydraulic calculations that sufficiently demonstrate that the 100-year floodplain will not encroach onto any building lots. Staff recommends approval of this preliminary plat with the following stipulations to be addressed in conjunction with final plat submittal. One, prior to consideration of final plat approval, the applicant shall submit HOA documents for review and approval by the county attorney's office. The approved HOA documents must be recorded prior to the recording of the final plat. Two, establishment of a performance bond for roads, drainage, and erosion control. Three, establishment of a performance bond for water improvements in favor of Mallory Valley Utility District. Four, establishment of a performance bond for sewer improvements in favor of Harpeth Wastewater Cooperative. Five, establishment of a maintenance bond for the landscaping comprising the Type C buffer between the portion of the development, between the portion of the proposed construction entrance that is located within the Harsh Landmark subdivision and the adjacent lot that is located within the Farmington subdivision. Six, submission of landscaping plans and establishment of a performance bond for landscaping. Seven, execution of a stormwater maintenance agreement and submission of an operation and maintenance plan for stormwater improvements. And eight, submission of the approved final plat in DWG format on recordable media based on the Tennessee State Plan Coordinate System prior to signature and recording of the plat.
Questions? Comments? Thoughts? Anyone? We've been working on this one, seems like, since I was a small child. But is there a motion? Motion made in second. Any further discussion? See none. Prepare to vote. Record it. Motion carries. Thank you. Agenda item 23 is withdrawn. Agenda item 24 was on consent. 25 is final plat review for Jerry Remus Property Large Lot Easement Subdivision reapproval containing five lots on 28.17 acres located off Bethesda Road in the second voting district. Staff.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This body approved this item at the June 2016 meeting. However, the applicant failed to record the final plat in the required 30 days, and it has since expired. The applicant is requesting reapproval of a large lot easement subdivision in order to create five lots. The plat is in order, and staff recommends approval subject to the following. A notice of coverage issued by TDEC will be required prior to the signing of the plat. A land disturbance permit must be obtained for the overall development, and driveway and drainage infrastructure must be complete prior to issuance of building permits.
Thank you, sir. Questions of staff? Final plat. Motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? I hear none. Prepare to vote. Vote now. Record it. Motion carries. Thank you. Item 26, final plat review for Rose Ridge Large Lot Easement Subdivision, containing four lots on 20 acres located off Forest Glen Road in the first voting district. Staff?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The property in question is approximately 20 acres in size and is located on Caney Fork Road, approximately 1/2 mile from Deer Ridge Road. The applicant is requesting approval of a large lot easement subdivision in order to create four lots, one with public road frontage on Caney Fork Road, and three off a 50-foot wide ingress-egress utilities easement. The site slopes steeply up northward from the road a quarter of the way into the property where it levels off. The remaining property slopes more gradually downward from the west to the east. The site is also heavily wooded. All zoning ordinance requirements regarding the protection of natural resources have been met. The applicant is proposing individual septic systems for the lots, and the Williamson County Department of Sewage Disposal Management is still reviewing the request. Approval is expected by meeting date. Water will be provided by individual wells on each lot, as no fire hydrants are proposed, and as none are currently located within 500 feet of the building envelopes. The building envelopes have been separated by 200 feet. The plat is in order, and pending approval by the Department of Sewage Disposal Management by meeting date, staff recommends approval subject to the following. One, a notice of coverage issued by TDEC will be required prior to the signing of the plat. Two, a land disturbance permit must be obtained for the overall development. And three, driveway and drainage infrastructure must be complete prior to issuance of building permits. And one additional item, the Department of Sewage Disposal Management has approved the request.
Comments? Motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? Prepare to vote. Vote now. Record it. Motion carries. Thank you. Agenda item 27 is withdrawn. Agenda item 28 is final plat review for Savage Point Woods Large Lot Easement Subdivision Revised, containing four lots on 34 acres located off Buchanan Lane in the second voting district. Staff.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This body approved this large lot easement subdivision containing four lots at the February 2016 meeting. However, the applicant failed to record the final plat in the required 30 days and it expired. The applicant is now requesting approval of revisions to the previously approved plat. As part of the previous approval or submittal, the applicant proposed extending the cul-de-sac associated with Savage Point Drive into Lot 1 and creating a 50-foot ingress-egress utilities easement off the end of the new right-of-way. The current plan is to leave the cul-de-sac in its present location and to have the easement begin at the terminus of the cul-de-sac to an area of previously dedicated right-of-way, the ownership of which has now been transferred to the applicant and is part of Lot 1. The temporary turnaround easement at the end of Savage Point Drive has been converted to a permanent easement. The applicant is proposing individual septic systems for the lots, and the Department of Sewage Disposal Management is reviewing the request. Water will be provided by Millcrofton Utility District from an existing 6-inch water line located along Savage Point Drive. As no fire hydrants are proposed and none are currently located within 500 feet of the building envelopes, the building envelopes have been separated by 200 feet per section 5.53 of the subdivision regulations. The plat is in order and pending approval by the Department of Sewage Disposal Management by meeting date. Staff recommends approval subject to the following. One, a notice of coverage issued by TDEC will be required prior to the signing of the plat. Two, a land disturbance permit must be obtained for the overall development. And three, driveway and drainage infrastructure must be complete prior to issuance of building permits. And one additional item, the Department of Sewage Disposal Management has approved the request.
Good. Thank you. Questions, staff? Motion and three times seconded. Any further discussion? I hear none. Prepare to vote. Vote now. Record it. Whoa. Record it now. Motion carries. Thank you. Agenda item 29 was on consent. We have a non-agenda item. It's King's Chapel staff. Who's got that?
I'll take that one, Mr. Chairman. This was actually just brought to our attention recently by the Emergency Management Agency. Apparently, just the small court that was previously named Gingerwood Court is a duplicate name of another subdivision street. So she just asked that we re-record with a new name that's been approved. And that's going to be Pinwheel Court. No other items are changing.
That's all it was?
That's all it is.
Motion. Motion made and seconded. We need a voice vote on this as a non-agenda. All in favor say aye. Opposed, no. The motion carries. Thank you. And item 30, amendment to the Planning Commission bylaws. Council?
Sorry. So I'm going to read the report and then we'll talk about some of the different changes if y'all have any questions. Okay, at the July meeting, the Planning Commission and staff discussed several potential amendments to the bylaws designed to allow additional public participation, clarify procedures for current public participation, including the filing of written comments, alter the meeting time in order for the meeting to be more easily attended, and other matters. Following that discussion, the Planning Commission asked the staff and legal counsel to bring back potential amendments to the bylaws for consideration. The amendments are attached in outline form describing the new provisions and highlighting changes to existing provisions. Also attached is a copy of the current bylaws with the proposed amendments highlighted as edits and a clean copy of the proposed bylaws. Below is a brief description of each proposed amendment presented for consideration. Number one, meeting time. Changes meeting start time from 7 p.m. to 5:30 p.m. Number two, procedure and deadline for filing written materials for consideration by the Planning Commission. This creates a subsection where written materials in any form must be filed with the Planning Department no later than noon, 2 days prior to the meeting date, describes the process of a new email address for the entire Planning Commission, notes that any written materials received after this deadline will not be considered by the Planning Commission in its deliberations or made a part of the official record, and defines what is included in these written materials. Number three, public hearing procedures, creates a subsection on public hearings that describes for what type of agenda items the Planning Commission will conduct a public hearing, describes the time allotted for each public hearing and each speaker, describes the process in which the public hearing will be conducted by the chairperson, including the use of a sign-up sheet for interested speakers, and describes the speaking rules assigned to the applicant and time limits applicable to the applicant. Number four, county commissioner participation. Creates a subsection related to the participation of a county commissioner in the meeting that defines the process by which a county commissioner may address the Planning Commission and for how long. Number 5, consent agenda, formally defines the consent agenda and what items may be included on the consent agenda. Number 6, ex parte communications. In addition to the language currently in the bylaws related to the Open Meetings Act, this creates a new provision which grants Planning Commission members the ability to direct public comments to the public participation process described in the bylaws, rather than having direct communications with the individual citizens and or applicant. Number 7, administrative cleanup items. It has been 8 years since the last time the bylaws were reviewed and updated. As a result, staff and legal counsel conducted an overall review and recommend some additional clarifications, including elections. Officer elections are generally held in August, as they are today, and have been for many years, but the bylaws cite that the elections are in June. The amendment reflects August as the month of elections, but also provides that an officer may continue to serve until elections are held in the event there is no August meeting. Membership. There have been 12 members of the Planning Commission for quite some time, but the bylaws reflected the standard Tennessee code language of no less than 5 and no more than 15. The proposed amendment merely reflects the true number of members of the Planning Commission. Deadline for submittals. Currently, the bylaws describe in detail the submittal schedule. This information is more appropriately located in the administrative manual, so this information is simply deleted from the bylaws and refers to the administrative manual for all of those submittal details. Publication. The provision related to publication of the meeting schedule has been amended to publish the meeting notice on the county website in addition to a local newspaper. Agenda and non-agenda items clarifies that applications must comply with the zoning ordinance, subdivision regulations, and administrative manual in order to be placed on the agenda. The proposed amendments also define what a non-agenda item is and how it may be placed on the agenda for consideration. Quorum. This clarifies the required quorum and the effect on quorum in the event of a recusal or abstention. Voting. This clarifies the procedure for taking action on an agenda item. Easy for me to say. The staff and legal counsel recommend adoption of these proposed amendments to the bylaws. Ooh, that was a mouthful. So I did this outline that's your attachment 30-1 because I thought that would be easier to digest, because once you start putting all these black line things in it, it's pretty busy. But for the most part, it's what we just talked about. But if you look through it, it has the detail and how we would then be, now be conducting the public hearings. We already talked about for what, the 50 lots or greater and the concept plan. But in order to accommodate the time limit on the public hearing and the time limit on the speaker, as we've discussed before, there has to be some sort of sign-up method. And so we're going to be placing sign-up sheets. It's kind of like they do at the county commission meetings, where you have to come before the meeting and sign up if you want to speak during their citizen communications. But it would be per item that are subject to the public hearings. And so the person that would be interested in speaking would come before the meeting. The document would be available 30 minutes before the meeting starts. And it would be provided that once the meeting starts, these things are going to be taken up. So you're going to have people streaming in, for half an hour still writing on these sheets. And so there's going to be some time for people to have to get used to this process. But they would come in, they would sign in that they want to speak on this particular item. When the meeting starts, staff would take up those speaking lists and then determine how long people get. Because you only get 30 minutes, but you only get 3 minutes. So you might need less than that if we have 30 people signing up. And so then after the chairman calls the public hearing and the staff report is read, the applicant makes a presentation. There's also a timeline on the applicant, and that's for all their people. So it's not 10 minutes per consultant, it's 10 minutes. And they can reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal if they need to readdress some things. Now, that doesn't stop you all from asking the applicant questions beyond that time frame. I mean, if they're done and they sit down and you all still need clarification of any of their consultants or staff or whatever, that doesn't cut any of that off. But it prevents the applicant from having 45 minutes when we're only giving the public 30 total. And so the sign-up sheets would then, the person would be called up according to when they signed in. So, and then they would have 3 minutes to speak, or maybe one, depending on how many there are.
Does that sort of cut both ways? If you have 30 minutes for that hearing and you only have three people, do they get to use 30 minutes?
No, they still only get three individually.
What do you do, ring a bell or yell out or...
Yeah, and that's the hard part. You get somebody up there that's wanting to read, and so they're reading.
And not paying attention.
Yeah, you have to interrupt them. I try to say, okay, you've got 30 seconds.
I'm not as nice as you are.
Well, you're not. I'll be interested to watch how you do it, because my way's not working too well.
I got it figured out. I'm going to get one of those little bells like you put on a hotel room, you know, and give it to Sheila. Let her do it.
Yeah.
So when there's 30 seconds left, you'll ding the
bell.
Well,
you know, I was thinking about that. I really don't want to be a timekeeper. I've got to sit here and I'd like to listen to the comments. One, if they ask questions, I'm obligated to deal with those questions after the end of that. So yeah. I really... Sheila's going to be the designated hitter here. I guarantee you that. But,
no, I don't disagree. There needs to be a separate timekeeper. You need to...
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you're the master of ceremonies, for lack of a better phrase, and so you can't necessarily keep up with the time, especially when you've got 30 people running through.
There's only 30 maximum people.
There's only 30 minutes. So,
right.
I mean...
But on the sheet...
Yes, if you could have 30 seconds at least, but that would not serve them very well, so you hope after people get used to this process they would consolidate their comments and send 10 people to speak rather than
one with them.
Yes.
We do, like, help encourage them in that. I mean, if we had 10 people sign up, I mean, to help facilitate initially to get people used to this, will we help facilitate them in saying y'all might want to, you know, get together and choose a speaker and
kind of guide them
a little bit?
That can be part of the before the public hearing starts, we only have 30 people, so you might want to make, you know, if five of you are saying the same thing, I mean, and I guess, I mean, the chairman already kind of gives that guidance now. We're just going to have to kind of play it a little bit by ear. But
well, I can think of a lot of questions. Does the 30 minutes include their time of lollygagging up here to the podium? Do we hit a 30-minute clock and when that's up?
I think if we have 30 people signed up for a minute apiece, they're all entitled to say they're 1 minute. So, I mean, I don't want to penalize.
I don't have a problem with it. I'm trying to make it.
They have a walker and it takes them a while to get up here. We say, oh, I'm sorry, you're down to 42 seconds. I mean, that's...
Well, I'm trying to make it where it's reasonably manageable and consistent.
And 30 doesn't have 45.
Amen. Yes, and that's the hardest problem you got to deal with. Is
you got
saying,
well,
I they won't say, most of them won't say the same thing that the other 44 said, though. So,
we've had at the county commission is somebody prepares a multi page speech, and I see that they put a lot of work into it, and there's 10 people that want to speak, so they or more, and they've only got a minute and a half, and that's...
Can you do like Congress and yield your time to the next guy?
I've had people do that, but just very seldom.
Okay, I'm just curious.
Well, what about...
You'll probably get asked that. There,
well,
five
I don't have a problem
five
with it. It's 30
up.
Minutes, guys, and when it's over, it's over.
I mean, what, you'll have one person, you know, five people say, well, we all signed up, but we want her to take her time. That kind of thing is going to have to fall within discretion of the chair, essentially.
I don't have a problem with that. If they agree to it, they're the ones that are here to make the speech.
Christy, I've got a question. Say that we have two subdivisions on the agenda. One's 50 homes and one's 75. So therefore, they could have two 30-minute sessions on the public hearing on each one of those.
If they're both concept plans, yes.
What? And I don't have the answer to this, but to me, we need to educate the public, because somebody might want to come in and say, well, I want to speak to this 20-home subdivision, and that doesn't fit in the public record realm.
Right.
So I don't know if on the sheet, if you said you want to speak to agenda item 50 homes.
I think we should have a separate sheet for the for each public hearing item, and it have at the top what the public hearing item is, and in all of our agenda description, it says how many lots on how many acres and the road that it's on. So I guess I was envisioning that that would be on there in addition to the time limit. I mean, the paper itself needs to be kind of educational.
Educational, and I agree.
Have we crafted that yet?
No.
Is that your job?
I'll come up with something and share it with the staff to review.
Share as much information with the public as you can so that it's manageable, please.
If somebody's late for a meeting, may not speak.
Nope.
Means they didn't get on the list.
That's in the...
That's right.
I read that too, Pete.
And that's going to be part of the education process. I mean, we're going to have to let people... I mean, we're going to have to work with people for a couple of months, but yes.
People that are complaining are hard to educate, I hate to tell you.
Well, we're giving people 30 minutes, and the county commission does something similar, and people know if they want to get on the list, they have to show up and sign up, and it's they caught on pretty quickly, I thought, with that process.
Would it not be reasonable as far as when the time starts is people come up to the podium, identify themselves, and after they've identified themselves, their time starts, so they have a... I mean, that would sound reasonable. Or walking up or whatever, you know, where who you are, where you're from, and then your time starts.
Right. We can handle it that way. I guess it depends on when Sheila's going to be required to ding.
Well, if she brings one of those baking things.
I'm used to that.
But, you know, we also could, you know, tell... we're going to have to feel it out, but it could be that we say, okay, the first five people are blank, 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 blank. Come on up. So they're standing here.
Queue up.
Yeah. Instead of one person speaking and sitting down and we wait for the next one to climb over the people. And that way they know and have them already up here standing waiting to go. That would alleviate some things too. So we're going to have to, the mechanics we're going to have to kind of figure out.
We'll see how that goes after the first one. I had a couple more thoughts. On a county commission person speaking, is there, you going to do time on that?
No.
Why not?
We haven't traditionally done time, and for the most part, they respect your time, and I don't think you've ever had
some of them do, some of them don't.
I understand.
They give their speech, and then we have a lot of discussion, and then they're in the audience, and other constituents are, you know, stuff in their ear, and then they want to come back up the second time, and
that's because at the discretion of the chair.
I don't like that part either.
You don't?
No.
Well, it's like they...
Well, I you get up and say
your
thoughts.
Because you may want to ask them back up yourself to answer a question. So
that's a different issue, though.
Right.
To answer a question, but why did you not put time on that?
Because we've not traditionally put time limits on it. They've done this for
years.
We hadn't
done that with the public either.
Well... we haven't really had public hearings on a lot of things in a while, so I just didn't, because of the elected officials. If you all want to put a time limit, we can certainly change that.
I think it needs to be a fairly generous time limit, but I think there needs to be one. I guess that's what I'm saying, and I'm really not crazy about having to say no all the time about jumping back up again every time they want
to
rebut.
Well, you don't
something.
Have to say no.
I,
you can say yes.
I understand.
That's why it's in your discretion.
I understand.
I mean, we could put something like 10 minutes, but now we're encouraging a time. You know, if you think of it.
What do y'all think?
If they only have 3 minutes to say, we don't want to say, well, you've got 10, and they'll feel compelled to fill it.
Well, unless you actually say to them at a meeting or whatever, be respectful of we're given 30 minutes for, you know, we could have 3 30-minute public hearings, and then they come up and speak for 10, 15, 20 minutes. I mean, it just gets be a long night, and then people get tired and don't really want to listen to everything else. So I think if they have an understanding that be respectful of your time up here, and you might get to come back and have a rebuttal if you're respectful from the chair. But I think it's about being respectful of the time and letting us...
Well, but the thing is, if we put a time on it, we're assuming they're not going to be...
No, I'm not saying
respectful.
Put a time on it. I'm saying be respectful, Jack.
Yeah, Jack.
30 minutes.
Yeah. What we don't want, and what we don't do on the county commission level, people will come up and say, "Well, what are you going to do about this?" So we don't engage them. They come up, they speak their mind, and then sit down because you
well,
can
but what
get.
What this says when you read it, Jack, is that the chairperson is charged with accumulating questions raised by the speakers, and at his discretion, getting answers to those questions.
But that's exactly what you do now.
I know that.
And so that's why I wrote it
down.
I
don't have a problem with that, and I think that's the way it ought to be.
Well, and you did a good job tonight when Commissioner Lawrence was up and asked some of the questions, and I thought they were good questions.
But you know, that's why I don't want to be a timekeeper.
Right.
First of all.
Yeah.
Okay. Say again.
And you know, we talked about historic, but we don't control the light. We don't control. I mean, there's things.
I'm trying
to
pick up on the ones that have a relevance.
Right.
They ask a lot of questions that, you know, you just kind of. Yep.
Talking about times, what is the 10-minute time on the developer? The reason I ask that is that when the Stevens Valley engineer got up and fully explained that?
Yes.
Because
that was a 30-minute speech.
And I agree, but it probably needed to be 30 minutes.
Well, and here's the thing with that. When we have these rules like this, and I took that time limit from another jurisdiction because I found that it works for them. From what I've researched, and the applicant knows they have X number of minutes, and they can take part of those to come back up and respond. And the applicant does all that before the public hearing, because the public hearing attendance folks need to hear that information. It may answer some of their questions.
What?
So I set it up that way. But to answer your question about the time, if it's a extraordinarily large development, it could be that, just like with any of these, you all could take some sort of action to suspend the rules and grant them 20 minutes.
Why can't we, I don't want any more authority, but why can't we just say at the discretion of the chair? I'd started to say complex or large developments.
I would say it is 10 minutes unless they request, you know,
Stevens had had the main guy and four consultants and the owner and.
Now this is just in conjunction with the public hearing.
I understand.
I mean, like Stevens Valley had a separate presentation, and it seems like if it's that type of development, that staff would want to suggest scheduling that at a prior meeting, like you've done before when they initially come in and do the big. But yes, that night they had like 20 or 30 minutes, and it seems to me if you all are aware of that coming up, you can vote to suspend the rules and grant them 20 minutes or whatever.
The developer knows he's got 10 minutes, then his presentation will be limited to that.
Well, I agree.
I would like
you know, he can cut some things out and get to the high points.
Well, there are occasions, though, like Stevens Valley, said, we learned some things about the development that we needed to know.
Yeah.
In the second time when they, I guess it was I don't remember how many times, but they came and did the overall presentation in, say, March, and we took no action, came back the next month and had some official rebuttals to a lot of the concerns the citizens. And then the county commissioners got up and said those concerns with traffic and this, but they specifically talked about, we're doing this at Temple Row, we're doing this at the next row, we're doing this. Here's what we're doing to address those concerns. That was more than 10 minutes the second time, you know.
It was.
And I'm okay with the 10 minutes,
if you want to put more in here, we can.
I would tend to not say put more. I just think there needs to be special occasions. If there's several issues that developer needs to address, and it's not because they've got a bad development, it's because they've got a complicated large development that there's a lot of passion in the group.
Can we not do that some other way than suspending rules and going through that hoop? Sir.
Why can't, because of the complexity of an issue, that the chair makes the determination to get the knowledge to the board that you're going to change the time limit?
And just say something along the lines of at the discretion of the chair?
Yes.
Okay.
I mean,
I've alienated everybody else. I might as well keep it up.
Stevens Valley, there was a lot of information, but there was a lot of repetition.
Oh, yeah.
On some things. So if the developer knows, you know, technically you kind of have this time limit, you know, get the most important information out there. If he goes a little over or whatever, thing as far as the discretion, but, you know, don't, there were some things in there, it's like, I could really care less about that, you know, on just to where it, they need to hit the high points.
Well, and there was about 10 or 15 people that taking turns coming up mm-hmm. and coming up and coming up.
And yeah, I'll be honest, I kind of checked out. And I hate to say that, but.
To your point, there was a lot of repetition, especially about the family, the life, and the experience you're going
to have. They were trying to sell the development.
They were. As a matter of fact, my son was in the audience when the developer came up and spent a lot of time at the podium. He said, he was like really brown-nosing y'all.
Do we want to keep the 10 and 2 like I have it for the applicant, but give the chair the discretion to extend that for more
complex
yes. development, write something like that?
Yeah, craft it some way along those lines. I think it would be, I'd just like to not have to jump through that, suspend the rules all the time and every time. Because it could get complex for even smaller developments when you've got lots of resources that you've got to deal with. I mean, I can see a lot of reasons that could happen.
This was the time I checked out, too. I'm sorry. So if we've got the total 30 minutes, you've had 10 people that spoke, but the 30 minutes is up. The rest of the people that's on that list...
No, I think we're going to have to consider a list of 30. I mean, you have 31-minute speakers or, you know, 5 3-minute speakers, so or just whatever. You still get 3 minutes no matter what, but if you have enough, then you might have to do 1 minute.
In the history of...
I think it is
to manage?
You can't say anything in 1 minute. I can't. But... I think it's going to be difficult, and I think if we're saying, I'm kind of with, we got to get better organized. Not we. If there's 30 people that want to talk, well, we don't need to hear the same thing 30 times. We need to hear it 10 times, 3 minutes each, knock it out. When 30 minutes is up, giving a little bit of leeway, cumulative, you know, when they start talking, hit the stopwatch. When they stop talking, stop it, but cumulative. 30 minutes is 30 minutes. And I hate to be that way, but we'll be here for an hour.
It'll take 45 minutes to do 30 minutes. Is that what you're saying?
Guaranteed.
Oh,
every
yeah.
time. If it's a controversy.
What we will ultimately find, too, as this is ramped out, we will find that people wanting to speak are going to start developing
strategies.
Perhaps, strategies on how they can effectively hit it. You know,
I think once they realize the system, I think that will in fact happen. It happens on your level, I'm sure, Jack.
Yeah.
This is already happening in other jurisdictions. We just have been very generous when we do have public hearings. It's just we've been limited in what we've granted public hearings on. And again, if it's not working, then we can fix it. If you all think we need 40 minutes or 20 or whatever.
Does the county?
This is what we're stepping out and trying, and then if it's not working out for you, then we
county continue. Commissioner need to sign in?
No.
As a speaker?
No. Because they can speak on anything, so they're not counted as part of the public hearing for the public. At least that's how it's drafted now.
Okay.
I think it'll start flowing, especially if they come a lot. And if there are 30 people, as John addresses the public hearing, there's 30 people. You literally have 1 minute, so please use that time appropriately. I think
there's going to be some transition process for them and us, and so. Now going to be conducting public hearings
50 lots.
For concept plans that are 50 lots or greater. Just the concept plan thing. So tonight we would have had three. Which is not too terribly different than when we used to do public hearings for the RCD. Anything else on the public hearing part?
Beach concert.
Yes. Unless you have, you know, two people. Then we'll just move along.
I'm just thinking of the number of people that were in the audience. We'd still be on concert. Pardon? So it wasn't the point of getting out early. It was starting earlier, so we still get out at the same time. Okay, I got you, Sam. All right.
What else, Christy?
Did y'all have any other questions about any of the other stuff I put in there? We're gonna work with the Katie and Mike, and I've talked about this, working with the IT department to get your personal emails off of the website and have that joint one Planning Commission email address that will go to everything. And so we'll let you know as soon as that's implemented. Part of that whole implementation process is working with the IT department to put all of this on the website so people are aware of what the new rules are and how to
You going to try to have a final cut for next meeting?
Of this?
Yeah.
I was trying to have one tonight.
I think there was just that one change.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
Just the change giving you the discretion to extend the 10 minutes for the developer.
I was thinking there was something else. Is that all you have, Christy?
Well, if y'all don't have any questions about the other provisions, there's a bunch of them in here, Mr. Crowan.
.1.6, isn't that a change from what we've been doing? When it says applicant does not receive majority of vote from those who are present to approve a denial or failure of lack of motion, the applicant is considered failed.
Yes, I've tinkered with that, but let me find it so I can tell you why.
That's not right. What we've done.
On the voting provision, that 8.1.6, I'd mainly changed it to make sure, like you asked, Mr. Chairman, that our procedure is reflected in the bylaws, that we discuss the item before there's a motion. The quorum, 8.1.5, I altered a little bit to clarify that when you recuse, that's not an abstention. So you're taken out of that vote. So when Robin recused herself, now I had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And they had to get a majority of the 9 instead of a majority of the 10 because she's recused. An abstention is a vote. So it's not a majority vote. It doesn't go to the majority. So that part of that was clear. I had read some cases recently where there was a debate about whether something actually got an approval or not for that very reason. So I wanted to clarify it.
But what I'm talking about is the last paragraph where it says a lack of motion. Considered a failure. I thought that with lack of motion, we considered it were passed.
If it's a lack of motion, traditionally in bylaws and Robert's rules, that means the request fails. However, because of our 60-day auto approval thing, I will almost never let you all get away with a lack of motion because you either have to vote it up or down. Like the bylaw thing, if you're voting on bylaws or subreg amendments, that's different. But all your subdivisions, there's going to have to be an up or down. There's not just a lack of motion.
So that's
good.
So this isn't what we go by.
If we have a lack of motion,
it's considered approval, not disapproval. No.
If it's a lack of motion, it's considered fail. It failed because no one took action to approve it. But that's really only going to come into play on things like subreg amendments or bylaw amendments or something, because all of our subdivisions will either have to have a motion to approve or motion to deny, all of them.
All right, that's a little confusing.
And so I think that caveat's in there, that little reference to the Tennessee Code that says except where Tennessee Code 13.3.4.14 requires specific action. So that's what addresses that auto approval thing.
Okay, thank you.
So we can handle this one of two ways. Y'all can vote to approve all of them but the public hearing one, or I can tell you the sentence I'm going to write that y'all want, and if you like it, you can vote to approve all of it.
Tell us.
If you look at 9.1.2, the public hearing one, And you're talking about in the applicant section, that sub D, the applicant may next present information, the 10-minute thing. Does everybody see that? At the end of that sentence, where it says the time frame shall be cumulative time of all representatives who speak on behalf of the applicant, I would propose that we say the chairperson may grant additional time for more complex developments. And leave it at that.
At the discretion of the chair. Mm-hmm. Okay. Those two changes is all you're making from what you've drafted. We can vote on it tonight if that's what you want to do.
I would.
Sure.
What Sammy mentioned makes a lot of sense to me, to have a person come up and give them 1 minute to speak. I don't see how that's workable. I would rather see people, you limit it, X amount of people come up and make a 3-minute speech. If they only go a minute, that's fine. If they go, but to, for them to come up and for 1 minute,
well,
I just don't
I think it. I think the way I would deal with that is when those forms are gathered up, they're going to, if there's more than one public hearing, they need to sort those out. And if we wind up with 30, I think I'm going to simply say, hey, folks, you need to strategize a little bit and consolidate your number of speakers in order to be effective in your presentation, and put that onus back in their camp rather than put it on our backs, and let them sort out who wants to speak about what.
It works well.
But they are used to that system.
Yeah, well, we used to have just 15 minutes, and then it was increased to 30 with a maximum of, just like we're doing here, with a maximum of 3 minutes per person. If there's 30 people, then they get a minute. Mm-hmm. And
the reality of it is, though, is in my history here, I can't remember a public hearing that had more than 8 or 9, 10 max.
We've never had that many. We've had 12.
We'll deal with it when we come to it. Yeah. It's a good point, though.
I mean, we're talking about increasing the number of public hearings, depending on if it's a concept plan or, you know, so essentially.
Well, you can have three a night.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. And then, like with the county commission, it's just at the very beginning, whatever they want to talk about. It's not per resolution.
That's
to
true.
Where
it's not item specific.
Right, like, and so that's what I'm saying. We could, you know, and I mean that's why we're serving, but we're opening ourselves up to a lot of time spent in a public hearing, which I want to know what the public says.
Of course, we're not talking that many. We don't have that many, but the Board of Zoning Appeals, each item is a public hearing. And we've never had a problem with it.
Okay.
Okay. Anything else?
So that's the only change, what I just read, to what you have written. You all are comfortable with that change, and then what's proposed, and you're comfortable adopting it tonight, then you would move to accept staff's recommendation and adopt the bylaws as presented. Bring you back a clean copy. Well, I'll email it to you. A clean copy of what it says after you've adopted it. It's going to take us a little while to implement. What?
Insert.
Yes.
Yep.
That I just
Does
read.
This have to go anywhere else?
Nope. It's all you.
Anybody have a problem doing it that way? Go ahead and get this in place.
I'll
We're going to need to start at 5:30. You're right.
Do it.
We need a second.
Second.
Voice vote.
Yes. What? Oh, you have it up there, Sheila?
It is up there. All right. We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? We're prepared to vote. Vote. Record it. Motion carries. Thank you.
Now,
anything else?
You have a voice vote thing that you all need to address now. Oh, you have it up there too?
I got that one up there.
Awesome. You all received a revised meeting schedule on your desk when you got here. In the event that you all adopted these bylaws, you know, every year we adopt a meeting schedule with the time of the meeting. Well, we're going to have to change the last 1, 2, 3, 4 meetings, the start time to 5:30. And so I need you all to approve the revised meeting schedule for 2016, and then we'll bring 2017 back to you another time. But this is just to start our meetings at 5:30 starting next month.
Motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? You say that's up there?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Any discussion? Prepare to vote. Vote now. Record it. Motion carries. Anything else?
Not yet.
We good to go?
Yep.
Thanks. All right, where are we? Ooh. You going to do that by voice? Election of officers. The floor is now open for nomination of a chairperson.
I nominate John Lackey as chairman.
Second.
Any other nominations? I'm going to wait and see how long y'all sit there. Any other nominations, seriously? All in favor of John Lackey, please say so now. Yes.
Aye.
That was overwhelming. What is it? Huh? Well, when you're the chair and you're like, it's like the Democratic Convention, I'm gauging the voice here. Vice Chair, nominations. Floor's open. Mr. Crowhan, any other nominations? I see none. All in favor of Mr. Crowhan for Vice Chair, please say so now. Aye, thank you. Secretary, who is this? That would be, I get the pro tem and the secretary turning around about that. All nominations for Secretary of the Planning Commission now open. Motion made and seconded. I'm not going to ask for any others. They might bring one up. All in favor say aye. Opposed no. Motion carries. Thank you. And for pro tem, is it Aaron? Yes, thank you. Motion made and seconded for Aaron for Secretary Pro Tem. All in favor say aye. Opposed no. Motion carries. Okay. Closed session. Gentlemen, we've got a closed session. We need you to unjoin us. We are adjourned. Thank you.